Do you know how awkward it is to be figuring out how to open your podcast, right? Because I'm not, hey guys, and I'm not some sort of uber, you know, really cool voice artist or whatever. So it's just really random to be looking at this sort of edit little garage band thing and going, hey guys, welcome to the You Don't Need to Know This podcast. So I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to say welcome and start. This podcast is just about stuff you don't really need to know. But you know what? There's probably a good reason to know it. And maybe we can look at the world and look at some really random stuff and figure out whether all of this information is really as useless as it seems to be. I don't know. Maybe, well, that's where we're starting with, and who knows where this will go. What I want to talk about today, it's nerdy and it's fun, and it's something, you know, the little kid inside all of us, or those of us who have little kids, you know, we know that they love it. And this is a factoid, fact piece of trivia or whatever about dinosaurs, right? So dinosaurs evolved about 250 million years ago, and you know, by about 150 million years ago, they pretty much ruled the earth. And about 150 160 million years ago, one branch of them, the theropod family, began to change into forms that we would be really familiar with today. And about 150 million years ago, there was one particular species, or rather genus, called Archaeopteryx. They found this in Germany, and they realized that actually looked like a bird, and they realized that birds really descended from the theropod lineage of dinosaurs. So there you have it, right? Birds are dinosaurs. They're a kind of dinosaur, right? So birds are theropod dinosaurs, highly derived, which is the evolutionary way, or rather the scientific way of saying that they've changed a lot from what their ancestors used to look like. They don't have their bony tails anymore. They don't have teeth in their beak, but they are very much dinosaurs. And they found feathered dinosaurs all over the place, and they realized, you know, the lineage goes back hundreds of millions of years, and very likely the earliest dinosaurs had some sort of keratinous filament, ancestral feather, and it was something that was fairly common across various dinosaur lineages. So that's the fact. Birds are dinosaurs is our big fact over here. And of course, you know, it's probably not news to most people. I mean, dinosaurs right now are just hot content, hot news. You know, everyone loves to nerd out a little bit about them, little kids especially. Dinosaurs right now are about as cool as Halloween is in India. And that's the thing. I don't know why Halloween is this cool right now. And I cannot for the life of me figure out why there are, you know, little, how should I put this, little subcontinental children walking around, you know, asking trick or treat, celebrating the night where souls, they rise to heaven, or whatever the mythology between All Hallows even is, which is what Halloween is, right? But dinosaurs are that cool right now. You know what? I guess that is an improvement. If I can watch Camp Cretaceous on Netflix in Hindi, that's better than 1992, where the Hindi dub of Jurassic Park was, "Dekho, dekho, bhayanak chipkali aaye hain," or was it "Daravni chipkali," or some such thing, which was like a literal translation of the word dinosaur, right? Terrible lizards. That's what it means, right? That's the Greek for terrible lizards, which is, it's sort of a portmanteau, which is two words put together to form a third one. And so they just said, okay, well, we'll just translate that into Hindi. So it became bhayanak chipkali, right? And so where we are right now is obviously an improvement, if you care at all about what people know about dinosaurs, for example, and paleontology as a whole. And of course, everyone knows the dino rock stars. Name a dinosaur and the little kid walks up and says, hey, of course I know T-Rex, Tyrannosaurus, Triceratops maybe, I don't know, Stegosaurus. But I feel really bad, because that really misses out on what's really interesting over here is India's dinosaurs, India's paleontological history, India's geological history, which is truly, truly fascinating. All right. I'm going to take a step back over here, and I'm going to talk about the geological history of India, right? So India was part of a giant southern continent called Gondwana. And Gondwana was basically all the southern continents today. It's Antarctica, Australia, Africa, South America. And one big piece of Gondwana was India and Madagascar. The whole southern region was called Gondwana because of certain rocks in the Gondwana, erstwhile Gondwana region of Madhya Pradesh, right? Where the Gond tribals live. And the whole sort of area was named, this whole giant supercontinent of Gondwana, the southern continent, supercontinent, was named for these rocks, right? Because they were of that time period. At some point, about maybe about just less than about 100 billion years ago, India broke away from this southern supercontinent, which was already breaking up. Africa sort of going on its way, South America going on its way, Australia going on its way, and Antarctica kind of being left where it is, right? And so India breaks away with Madagascar and shoots like super fast across the Southern Ocean and slams into the sort of soft underbelly of Asia, which is why you have the Himalayas today, right? And the Himalayas are still growing because India is still sort of grinding in over there. And so for this amazing journey from the southern landmass all the way north into the underbelly of Asia, India and Madagascar were together for a large part. They split around the area of the Seychelles, okay, where there was massive eruptions, etc. So we had this super, super interesting, unique fauna, animals and plants and things like that, which were like nothing else in the entire world because of our isolation. And so you had these really cool dinosaurs and various other kinds of animals as well. So obviously they got named things like Rajasaurus and Isisaurus. So Isisaurus is basically Isisaurus because the Indian Statistical Institute Saurus. I don't know why it was named for the Indian Statistical Institute, but I mean, there you go. And Barapasaurus, which actually is Bada Pao Saurus, Bada Pair, right? So Bigfoot Saurus, because apparently the workmen who were extracting it were talking about how Bada this Pao is. And the white dude who was doing, like, overseeing the extraction and telling the coolies what to do, Yaha Nahi Waha kind of thing, picked up on that. And said, okay, well, this is really cool. I'm going to call it Barapasaurus. And that, in a nutshell, is the story of paleontological sort of research in India. You know, it's pretty much white dudes coming in. And there's an exception to this. There's a big exception to this in Balasinore, right? Which is an old princely state in Gujarat in the Narmada Valley. The erstwhile princess of Balasinore actually took a passion to digging up dino fossils and things like that. And she's discovered huge sauropod nests. Sauropods are the sort of long neck giant dinosaurs, like huge nests with eggs at Balasinore, and it's huge, and there's a lovely park over there which I'm really looking forward to take my daughter to. But beyond that, really, there hasn't been serious scholarship, serious work with the paleo history of India. And yes, of course, there are people who have done, etc., but I'm saying it's not really been in our national consciousness the way it has been in many other countries. And especially, and I'm going to really, you know, be treading a little softly over here, or carefully over here, but certainly not the way it has been in China. For over a century now, has had, or maybe around about 100 years, has it started with something called the Cenozoic Research Laboratory. Cenozoic Research Laboratory, which was started around 1929, and it evolved into something called the Institute of Vertebrate Paleontology and Paleoanthropology. All right. So for about 100 years, China has understood that it is important to have deep and meaningful research into the origins of this planet, into the origins of life on this planet, and paleoanthropology is the origins of human being. All in all, a well-rounded and deep understanding of life on this planet. And I want to take a step back, and I can imagine a lot of people saying, what's the point? What's the point of knowing this, right? Is this useful? Do I really need to know that dinosaurs existed up to 67 million years ago? You know, right now dinosaurs are like this Santa Claus thing, right? They're like, you grow out of it. You turn like 13 or 14 and you're like, okay, girls, boys, or whatever gender you're interested in. Then money, because, you know, hey. And then between that, really sex, and then alcohol, and then, and you know, all the other stuff. And suddenly this is not important. None of this stuff is important. And the thing is, I don't know. I've always been attracted to useful information because somehow I've always felt a wide cultural milieu, as opposed to a singular focus on one or two things, is a rich cultural milieu, right? So when your culture has many, 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 many facets, and your culture is about so much more than just one or two things, there is depth, richness, and there is so much more to it. And that's why it's so important for us to know stuff, like to know about our dinosaurs, to know about our paleontological history. And I'm not pulling some, you know, Atmanirbhar Chipkali story over here, right? I mean, that's not the agenda over here. It's about knowing more and having sort of a richer world to live in, right? And what it also does is I've always felt when I start reading about, and since we're talking about dinosaurs and birds over here, right? When I start reading about it, it also helps me understand our world. It helps me understand our place in the world. It also helps me understand why the world is where it is. There is a brilliant map that I saw on Twitter the other day. It's a map about how there's a swathe through the American South. And since the American elections are so hot right now, right? So there's a swathe of counties through the American South. To break this up, basically, the American South largely votes for Republicans. This swathe of counties is a few counties that vote for Democrats, all right? And I'm not getting into the race and the history and the bloody, bloody, blah. I'm not getting into any of that. Just this is the fact. And why do these counties vote Democrat? And so these are largely black counties. And why are they largely black counties? Because these are counties which were historically counties which had a large proportion of slaves and a large slave population. And after emancipation, the descendants of these slaves continued to live there and formed a large proportion of the population. They vote Democrat. Why were these slaveholding areas? Because they were where cotton and tobacco used to grow. Why did cotton and tobacco grow there? Because the soil was a special rich black soil, which was really conducive to growing these crops. Why was this soil specific to this swathe of counties? Well, 100-odd million years ago, sometime in the Cretaceous, the American coastline, that area was formed the American coast. So it was about a few hundred miles north of Florida and above the Gulf of Mexico, right? It was much north, a few hundred miles north of where the coastline is now. And as the coastline, you'd have a lot of organic material that would flow into the coast, and then you'd also have plankton die-offs, and you'd have zooplankton die-offs, etc. And so all of that settled at the bottom of that shallow coastline. And you'd have like the coral, sort of coral organisms, etc., reef organisms and all, and they'd all settle at the bottom. And it formed this band of really mineral-rich soil. And then 67 million years passed after the end of the Cretaceous and blah, 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 blah. And finally, you had this really rich band of soil running through what was then sort of the mid-south or whatever, a few hundred miles north of the Gulf Coast. And it was great for growing cotton and tobacco, which were slaving crops. And so your slave plantations were set up over there. And then the slaves were emancipated, 1864-65. And today their descendants who still live there vote Democrat. So you have a line of blue counties through an ocean of red, because about 100 million years ago, tiny sea creatures died and formed an extremely fertile bed at the bottom of a shallow sea shore. And that is just, I mean, it's a long and involved story, and I don't know if like a whole bunch of people tuned out in the middle of this, right? But that's the thing. If you know your past, if you're interested in the world around you, if you know your damn dinosaurs, you end up knowing a lot more about who you are and why you're here and why your world is the way it is. And you care about it, see, because when you understand and when you're aware of where you are in the world and why you are in the world, you also have a stake in the world. There's ownership, there's skin in the game. Hey man, I understand that this has been going on for however long it's been going on, and how can I kind of make sure that my impact on this world is a positive one, right? So that's our skin in the game. And then you start finding out about all kinds of shit. Did I know, since we're talking about coastlines, that there are coral colonies at Haji Ali in Mumbai? And I'm going, okay, You got to be kidding me. Coral colonies in Haji Ali. I mean, at this point, my assumption would be that the waters around Mumbai are more fecal matter than actual seawater, right? It's probably more poop than H2O. But apparently there are living coral colonies. Now, they don't form reefs, but they are coral. And I've seen some of the pictures and they're bright red and blue and various kinds of coral. And of course, now we're building the coastal road because, you know, four dudes want to travel really fast in their cars from like north to south Mumbai or whatever. We could be having like a really in-depth metro system, but that's not happening, right? So anyway, so we've got like the coastal road happening. And so these corals need to be relocated or we are going to lose corals that live on Mumbai's coast. If you aren't interested in a world beyond movies, alcohol and money and whatever, you know, your vice of, I don't know why I'm not dissing alcohol, I'm not dissing movies, I'm not dissing money, all right, but I'm just saying I love all three, but I'm just saying if that is the sole focus of our society and our life and on the things we talk about and what we live about, then we're going to miss out on this shit and we won't understand why it's important and we lose so much. We're losing pieces of a world that we don't even know are there. And that's really sad. I mean, you don't want that, right? Here's another thing. And so in my, where I live, we've been doing a bit of a, I don't know what you want to call it, a re-greening or a gardening kind of initiative. Because, you know, during the lockdown, all the uncles in the building have a lot of free time, right? So suddenly, like a whole bunches of new sort of plants have been coming up in the building, common garden areas and things like that. And what I've been noticing is we're getting whole bunches of birds, all these new birds. So obviously before this was like Bombay has crows, pigeons and sparrows and the sparrows are dying. So there's basically, you know, pigeons and are cat food and there's crows who are just like, crows are dicks. Right, they're smart dicks, they're like the smartest birds around, but they're just, I mean, you know, they're just noisy and full of shit all the time, just bullying everyone, right? So it was bird life in Bombay is pretty crappy. Suddenly, with this re-greening and, you know, having, a few more flowering plants, native plants, whatever, you're kind of, actually what you're doing is you're building up the insect ecosystem. And when you're building up the insect ecosystem, what you're seeing is that smaller birds, that you know, say like sunbirds, for example, that drink nectar, kind of like hummingbirds, and slightly larger birds like fantails and things like that, who live in hedgerows and in bushes and feed on little insects and caterpillars, who are also growing because of the broad range of green now, and then slightly larger birds like crow pheasants or cuckolds, and then you've got drongos. And then you've got, and suddenly, you know, kingfishers. And suddenly I've noticed like there are some 9 or 10 species of birds that are suddenly here. And as much as it's a pain to really, you know, hang with building uncles beyond a point, right? But if you're getting something done and you're literally seeing the flowering of life in a sense, you know, beyond crows, really, that's pretty amazing, man. And we've gotten from dinosaurs, birds to many kinds of birds in Bombay. Because we kind of understand that there is a historical connect between the theropods that roamed this particular piece of Gondwana and the theropods that roam our skies today. And we know this because we're open to living rich, layered, understanding lives, right? And knowing a little bit more about the world around us. And so I'm able to tell my daughters perhaps stories that are a little more rich and layered and meaningful. And when that happens, they're going to live even more rich, layered lives. And they're going to, I hope, years from now, build like a rich, layered society that is about so much more. And that's really, and the amazing thing is the outcome of that is something as powerful as Jurassic Park, because what Jurassic Park really is, all right, what it really is mythology in the making. It's literally mythology. And I might do this actually as a later episode, but what are superheroes, right? What are the Avenger movies and comic books and all of that, but our need to retell our mythological stories with heroes that we can better relate to, all right? The heroes that are more relevant to the world today, as opposed to heroes relevant to a world 1500 or 2000 or 2500 years ago, right? That's the real power of living this kind of you know, sort of learning useless knowledge kind of life. You get a chance to actually put all of that into the mythology that we are all creating today. We are all a part of making something amazing. And we can tell new mythologies if we know enough useless information. Mythologies aren't about giving you the science of making money. Mythologies are about making sense of the world around you. And that happens with what we call useless now, right? And the thing is, that's the thing about useless information also. It's not useless. It's actually, I don't know, man. I feel it's optimistic, right? Because imagine the sense of wonder you feel, just the world around you, right? It's amazing. It's about getting out there and being open to being surprised and made sort of joyous every day. And so that's why I love it. And that's a wonderful, wonderful feeling. This idea that we're part of something so much bigger. And I think I'm going to end this here because I could just go on and on. That's the first episode of You Don't Need to Know This. So my next episode will be next week. I have a bunch of topics I'd like to talk about. We might talk about a drug lord empire, or we might talk about genocidal cats, or we might talk about the truth of some superfoods, which will be fun. There's a bunch of stuff that I'd like to talk about, and I'd kind of put that together. I'd love for you to sort of rate this, leave comments, give me feedback, tell me how I can make this better. Go for it. Be brutal, not too brutal, please. And just help me make this better for you and for me and the entire human race. Heal the world. Okay, chalo, bye.